Hey everyone, I'm Rick Beato. Today's episode is part two of the series on the history of the guitar. The first broadly covered the years 1929 through 1969. And going forward, I've decided to zero in and focus by decade on how the great guitar innovators influenced the music, particularly in the rock and jazz genres. In this episode, we'll focus on the years 1970 through 1979, a period when some of the most significant developments occurred for the role of the guitar, a period when artists left a vast and rich trove of recordings unparalleled in significance to this day. The confluence of the British invasion in the 60s, the influence of the blues, and the sonic and technological advances for the guitar provided a rich and fertile base for the incredible growth in all styles of the guitar, leaving us the legacy I'll be exploring in this episode. Between June 1968 and September 1970, we lost two of the greatest players in their respective genres. Wes Montgomery, who is considered one of the most important jazz guitarists of all time, unexpectedly died of a heart attack at the age of 45. And then in 1970, the music world was once again rocked by the unexpected death of Jimi Hendrix, widely regarded as one of the most influential electric guitarists in the history of popular music, who died at the age of 27. The early 70s saw the rise of two new classical guitarists, Christopher Parkening and John Williams. Not John Williams the composer, but John Williams the Australian guitarist. A monumental record in classical guitar, in my opinion, is Christopher Parkening's 1972 release, Parkening Plays Bach. Here's a live recording of Parkening playing Jesu, Joy of Man's Desiring. Guitarist John Williams also came to prominence in the early 70s. Here he is with guitar legend Julian Bream playing a guitar duet. In blues guitar, the 70s brought many of the same guitarists that became famous in the 60s, like B.B. King, Albert King, and Freddie King. We also had some newcomers, like Bonnie Raitt. Here are some great blues guitar performances from the 1970s. Another amazing blues guitarist to emerge in the 1970s is Roy Buchanan, who can be seen here playing live in Austin in 1976. Jazz guitar took a massive leap forward in the 1970s as well. Guitarists like Pat Metheny came into prominence with his breakthrough album Bright Size Life in 1975 that featured Jaco Pastorius on the bass and Bob Moses on the drums. In a 2001 interview, Metheny discusses why he was drawn to the guitar in the first place. He says, "I come from the middle of the generation that viewed the guitar almost as an icon of some sort of youthful revolution. It began in the 50s and continued in the 60s when I caught the wave. It was most personified by the Beatles, and I was about 7 or 8 when the Beatles began to have hit songs. They brought to my mind a consciousness concerning the guitar that wasn't there before." 1973 saw the release of Joe Pass's Virtuoso, which is widely regarded as one of the greatest jazz guitar and solo jazz guitar records of all time. If you don't have Virtuoso in your jazz guitar collection, it's not complete. Here's a clip of Joe from 1976 doing what he does best. Newcomers like John Scofield, John Abercrombie, and Ralph Towner also started making a name for themselves in the 70s. Another guitarist to emerge in the 1970s is English guitarist Alan Holdsworth. Holdsworth combined the improvisation of jazz with the power of rock and the harmonic complexity of modern classical music. He can be seen here playing with his band Soft Machine in 1974. Music.
Philadelphia native Pat Martino released some of my favorite jazz guitar records of the 70s. This is from the album Consciousness, released in 1974. Another Pennsylvania native, George Benson from Pittsburgh, made the transition from jazz guitarist to R&B star with his 1976 release Breezin'. Breezin' was a triple platinum selling album and featured the Grammy winning R&B hit This Masquerade. In country music, many of the same guitarists from the 60s became even more popular in the 70s, like Jerry Reed and Glenn Campbell. But we also had some newcomers. Guitarist Roy Clark, who made his debut in the late 60s, really came to prominence in the 70s. And also Leo Kottke, whose eclectic fingerstyle playing draws upon country, blues, jazz, and folk music. Here are some of the stars of country guitar from the 1970s. In rock music, the 70s brought an explosion of stylistic diversity that will probably never be seen again. There were so many innovations that went on in guitar in the 70s. It wasn't just Eddie Van Halen with the first Van Halen record in 1978. Tom Scholz made the first Boston record a couple years before, which was unlike anything anyone had ever heard. But you can just start the 70s with guitarists like Terry Kath, who was just an amazing guitar player from Chicago. What I decided to do is I decided just to put them, not in any particular order, but one back to back, just so you can get an idea of how diverse these guitarists were. Check it out. We'll be right back. The 70s was also the era of dual guitar solos. Two of the biggest dual guitar solos of all time, Hotel California, seen here with Don Felder and Joe Walsh playing. And then we have Gary Rossington and Alan Collins of Lynyrd Skynyrd playing Freebird. This is what I grew up through as a guitar player coming up in the 1970s. That's all for now. Please subscribe here to my Everything Music YouTube channel. If you're interested in the Beato book, go to my website at www.rickbeato.com. And remember, if you want to support my channel, you can do it through the Beato Club that you can also find on my website. Thanks for watching.